Welcome to A Night's Tale Commentary. I'm Brian Helgeland, the director.
And I'm Paul Bettany, an ill-advised adolescent.
Otherwise known as an actor. That's the Columbia logo. She's holding that torch up for about 75 years.
When's it going to get to our names?
Not for a bit. Oh. But this is our brief explanation of jousting. Try to put the audience at ease. And that's Tom DuPont getting hit in the head and getting knocked out cold. Yeah, he hit the ground unconscious right there. And so we were determined to use the shot, even though it was a mistake. But you can see the two tips of the lances bounce together, and one of them pops up and hits him in the head, which wasn't supposed to happen. That's Dead Serector.
Yeah, I might be wrong, but doesn't this dead Serector look very different from the alive Serector?
Yeah, yeah. He had shaved
right
in the ensuing 12 years from when we meet him alive.
And had some surgery, I believe. Yeah.
And here we have the fabulous Heath Ledger and Mark Addy, opening of the film. Alan Tudyk running in there from the left, taking a long time to get up to Heath.
Yeah.
3-0 after 2 lances. All Serector needs to do is not fall off his horse and we've won.
I'm already convinced no one knows what's going on. 3-0 to whatever it was he said.
You've made it entirely clear, I think. Now, has anybody noticed how much Heath looks like Tom Hanks in that movie where he's...
In Castaway. Yeah.
At this
point. In fact, we're pretty sure that the people from Castaway stole some early hair and makeup tests.
Yeah, they did.
Because Tom Hanks was pretty keen on this look. Here's one of our Czech actors who I really enjoyed.
No, he was great, actually. He's really brilliant.
Yeah.
He didn't go to the same pirate school of acting that some of the others went to later in the movie.
The kind
of
arr.
Mark Addy, probably the finest actor.
Yeah, doing one of his incredible reactions that he has. I mean, if you're watching this movie for the second time, you should ignore who's ever talking and just
watch whoever
isn't talking, really, because everyone is doing some incredible stuff.
I'm asking you, William Thatcher, to answer me with your name.
I always wanted to write that line, "What's your name, William?" It's kind of a... You wonder why he's asking, don't you? If he uses the guy's name in the question.
Exactly.
The landscape is food. Do you want to eat or don't you?
If the nobles... That's very key to this movie.
Hero shot. There you go. What a smile.
Errol Flynn. Here we are with one of our very early uses of the crane in the film. I can actually tell the truth now that second unit was in bad weather and waiting for the rain to stop and decided to shoot this stuff, basically with very little knowledge on my part.
Really?
Yeah, yeah. But it was fantastic. I mean, Kevin Stitt, who edited it, called me up and... He said, let's just go for it. And we decided to go for it and actually get the crowd going.
Well, it's at this point, I think, in the movie that you realize it isn't going to be a serious cinematic dissertation on life in medieval Europe, is it?
This is not your father's Oldsmobile, I think.
Rufus Sewell, Sir Rufus Sewell, as I believe he's known.
Paul Bettany, soon to be Sir Paul Bettany. Shannon.
Lady Bettany, I believe.
Shannon came to Los Angeles to be a dancer, so we put her over a girl dancing. Alan Tudyk, fantastic.
Over a horse for what reason?
I don't know. I'm not sure. The beautiful Laura Frazier.
Yeah.
Very talented. Chris Kazanoff, who was in the very first thing I ever directed, which was Tales from the Crypt.
James Purefoy, who is known in England as James Puresex.
Yeah.
And should play Bond one day.
Voted the sexiest man in the film by the female members of the cast.
Yeah, that stung.
Caroline Harris, very talented.
Genius.
Armor and costume design. Carter Burwell, who did a fantastic job. Had a lot of rock music to contend with, and I think contended with it in a very great way. Kevin Stitt, very close friend of mine. Saw me through a lot of tough times.
And there you go.
There's Todd Black. His name rhymes with something. We can't really talk about
it. No, we're not allowed to go into details.
No.
fear of being sued, I believe. Brian Helgeland. God, it took a long time to get to your name.
It did. You didn't know the horns were playing that Brian May guitar solo, but they were. And someone came up to me and said, you know, they didn't have Queen in medieval times, and I felt quite foolish when I found that out. It was so one of those clever, stupid. There's Barney the Wonder Horse.
Yeah. Barney actually was able to hit his marks, which is kind of an extraordinary thing.
Yeah. When you see every other horse in the movie is bouncing around like a ping pong ball, Barney probably saved us about 3 days of shooting.
Yeah.
He's a pro.
He's an absolute pro. Played your whole life, selected to shot himself to death. Wait, this is... see? Funny.
The flag goes down. Barney's ready.
Oh, there you go. Wow. There's, you see, now that's why me and horses don't get on.
Yeah. That's actually that shot of the horse rearing up is a second unit shot. But Alan and Mark came back from second unit that day and said, he's trying to kill us. And it was a while before I could convince any actor to go back on a second unit again.
Well, that's because he was a madman.
Yeah, the he being Alan Graf, who, fantastic second unit director, played for the Rams for 2 years.
Played small parts in movies, yeah. Been a stuntman.
He's actually in L.A. Confidential. He's the guy that Russell Crowe beats up in the beginning of the film.
Yeah. He was once a pole dancer, I believe, as well. He's done everything, that man.
And there he is. He gets hit in the head. And I always love this. And Mark's trying to make sure that Heath's alive. And Alan...
just wants to eat.
Yeah. These guys are just brilliant together. Is Barney getting a well-deserved kiss. Great sound effect right there.
That always gets a massive laugh, yeah. In the cinemas.
Sir Ector, remove your helmet.
This was actually in history. There was a guy named William Marshall who jousted, and he actually once had his helmet so smashed onto his head that he couldn't get it off.
Is that right?
Yeah, and that's where I got this from. I
present your champion, my lord.
Oh.
Did he get it off?
He did get it off. It took a while. He was never quite the same man that he was before it got bent, but.
Nobody ever is.
No. And here they are winning the Palme d'Or. I think the film, I don't know if it, I don't think it's going to win the Palme d'Or, but since I know that since we didn't get into Cannes, so.
Quick enough.
No.
That's all.
But there it is. They got it. And here Mark's selling the Palme d'Or for 15 silver florins.
There's a brilliant use of the instrument, the triangle, coming up in a minute.
Yeah, it's like one of
as
those.
A thought comes to.
Yeah, it's the light bulb going off over his head. There's Alan's pillow that we actually did a lot more with in the film, and unfortunately it got cut out.
Five for Roland, who's going straight home to England, straight to the pub.
And Heath's going to look up, and the triangle's going to go off as he has the idea.
I can feel it coming. There you go. How about that?
Now, this is another example of someone. It's like Paul Newman says, I have great vision, and the rest of the world wears bifocals.
Yep.
But Heath's got a plan, and as usual, the people around a guy with a great plan don't quite see it at first.
Never. Well, now, come on,
give me a coin. But they're friends, so hey, that's you stand by your friend.
Right, now that's one for you.
And there's a little bit of mathematics going on here.
For you. Which leaves 13.
There you go. It's 15 minus 13. 15 minus 2 equals 13.
Thank you for pointing that out.
And that's for the kids, really. I didn't think... Sometimes in a film, mathematics gets left out. And I think...
In America, you say math, don't you?
Yeah, we say math.
And we say maths.
Right.
Back in England, because we usually do more than one sum during a class.
But 2 plus 2 in both countries...
Equals 4.
Exactly. Yeah, thereabouts. Now he's going, this is very symbolic, he's taking the road less traveled right here.
But you can't even joust.
Well, most of it is the guts to take a blow, to strike one. Guts I have. And technique? I have a month to learn that.
So really, technique is guts comes first, and technique, I think, is second in almost any endeavor.
Even writing.
Yeah, exactly. Guts and, you know, guts. Just
now, I want to ask why that man was real, because I was there that day, and that guy in the back... was hanged.
You know, the irony is, not the irony, but the thing about being hung is a, there's a groin kind of sling that they sit in that takes the weight, and by the end of the day, he was not a happy man.
No, that's got to hurt. That's got to hurt,
yeah.
As they say in wrestling.
And but he looks real because he is real.
Yeah, he's quite far in the background, though. You could have used a dummy, couldn't you?
We did,
just cruel.
I think I just wanted to hang someone up there, I guess.
No, I always think of this, the Keanu Reeves moment in The Matrix here.
Right, where you can take... And you can also pick which pill you want to take.
Oh, yeah.
You see, money doesn't matter.
But in fact, it's kind of the only thing that's important.
Absolutely. This is a sort of gritty social realism at this point.
It's the kind of, it's why the music drops out there, because I'm really playing it real.
Using the real atmos.
Yeah. This was actually a real fight over it. That was a per diem that he had, and it was a real fight over it. 13. Now this is where you really realize that Roland is in charge. If he doesn't say they can go, they're not going. So it's up to Roland.
God love you, William.
I know. No one else will.
But these two guys do love him, in fact.
Yep. There you go. It's clear.
Here we go. Low Rider, favorite song of mine.
Written, I believe, in the 14th century.
Yeah. Another again. Stupid. The thing I can never figure out is that Low Rider doesn't need any gas. I can never figure that out. And what we're really saying, though, is that you can be a low rider, whether you're in your chopped 63 Chevy or if you're on Barney the Wonder Horse.
Barney the Wonder Horse.
Because being a low rider is a state of mind.
Now, there are a few historical inaccuracies, as we've mentioned, with the music. And you'd think if you were working for a big studio like Columbia or Sony, that somebody would point that out to you and kind of shield you.
Yeah. The thing is, no one from Sony Music was watching my back.
No.
And they just let me go the whole way. And then it took...
And once you've committed to it with the kind of, we will rock you at the beginning, there's little or nothing you can do to kind of change.
You know, it's that point, I don't know what it's called, but it's the no turning back point.
It's called the no turning back point.
Yeah.
Sounds long-winded, but...
I thought it was the vanishing point, but that...
No. That's a completely different thing.
Yeah. Here's another great reaction from the two guys.
Come on.
They don't want to have to do it again.
Come on, ponies.
Fong him.
Fong is kind of an interesting word that we use in the film. And it means to kick.
Does it?
Yeah.
It's an actual word.
Yeah, it means to kick.
That's how you got away with it, because it does bring to mind another expletive.
Yeah, but it's not. And in fact, I was questioned about it for the airline version. And I assured everyone it means to kick.
Right.
So if you don't do this, I will fong you. I will kick you.
I will kick you.
Yeah.
This is a great reaction. Yeah, there you go.
As Alan slowly realizes he might be dying. What, I should say. I just want to point out for the film school students that I did this in one. It's called a one-er in the business.
Yeah, they called it a one-er.
A lot of rehearsal went into this.
Boom, not a cut in it.
Nope. Here we go. We're on our way now. He's getting better.
Oh, I've missed the bit I like where he goes, I think he's getting worse. He is getting worse. That's my favorite bit in the movie.
Now he's getting better.
Right.
I just want to point out this is the Phoenix rising up from his ashes as he comes up over. But we're about to introduce the character of Geoffrey Chaucer.
Yes. I'm probably going to go quite quiet in a minute.
Yeah.
The reason will become obvious.
There's a lot to talk about here, but first of all, the movie happens in 1370, and I discovered from my research that Chaucer was missing for about 6 months back then. So this is what he was doing. I think a great entry.
Thank you.
A great introduction of you for American audiences.
Thank you very much. My entrance into the movie is indeed my entrance, if you take my meaning.
Yeah. And we knew we were going to be PG-13, so we had a lot. This is a very interesting shot.
It's a very strange experience to be sitting in a cinema and see your buttocks get a laugh.
Yeah, and about a 30-foot buttocks by the time you get on screen.
My buttocks broke into the American market before I did, frankly.
I should tell everyone I've known Paul. He was the only member of the cast that I knew, and I wrote this part for him. And it was really kind of as a dare to you, having nothing to do with anything important to the movie.
Absolutely nothing.
I guess, of course, it means I wanted to work with you naked, which is a whole other story.
Wait, let's not go into that now, Brian.
But now I should mention that when Sony wasn't so convinced, and they thought that you had to be funnier, that you were a little Hamlet-y.
Yeah.
So in my house, we worked out this bit where you put your nose.
I put my
in between your toes.
Which is bloody funny.
In a way to convince the studio that you were, in fact, probably the next Danny Kaye, I guess.
Yeah.
Then I liked it so much, we decided to keep it in the film. No. I remember I came up to you that day and said, can you do that thing where you put your nose between your feet?
And I said, please don't. The writer? Yes, nudity on set. The thing that you'll really notice if you are ever nude on a set is that people tend to look you right in the eyes. Also, at some point, your mate, the director, comes up to you, quite seriously says, Paul, when you sit down, we're seeing your old fella.
Yeah.
And behind him, you see a burly Czechoslovakian, oh, I should say Czech guy now. You see a burly Czech guy with a piece of duct tape. And it's at that point, you know, actually how far friendship goes.
Yeah, yeah. And it's an interesting thing on the set. Everyone's responsible for something. So when it comes to taping the old fella to the inside of the thigh so that no one will see it, I have to sort of go to the crew and ask who's
who
responsible.
Wants to do that.
And generally anything with tape, it's the grips.
Yeah, and they're huge.
Yeah.
I'm Richard the Lionheart, pleased to meet you.
This is actually where I'm about to fall down.
We had a great grip on the film who you actually work with a lot, named Di Hopkins.
Yeah.
And he immediately
said
pointed
no.
out that it wasn't his, it didn't fall within his jurisdiction.
It becomes a union problem if you actually do tape somebody's fella to the side.
Yeah, there's overtime involved and holiday pay and combat pay.
And see, I'm here to tell any viewers watching this that if they are taping their old fella or indeed any genital to the side of their leg, when it comes to taking off, do the slowly, slowly, slowly thing and not the 1, 2, 3, go. Because if you do the 1, 2, 3, go, you tend to lose slightly more than your pride.
Yeah. This is where Chaucer has them by the ball,
short
so to speak.
And curly.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, what I always loved about the scene was he was basically the only person that didn't know he was naked, the way you played it.
Yeah. Well, my theory was to make a virtue out of being naked for 5 days or however long I was naked during the filming of this movie. And I thought, if you can do it covered in bruises and mud, if you can be naked in bruises and mud and still have a smile in your face, the audience will kind of forgive you if you're crap later on in the movie.
He's going to kick you.
He's going to kick me.
That's one of Alan's lines. Your entrails will be your extrails. When he came into audition, and this, the second it came out of his mouth, I said, I don't want to steal it from him, so I got to cast him.
No. You have too much honor.
There's the tournament grounds at Rouen. We added some nice fake cathedrals in the background.
Now, what's the sound? Is the sound a slowed down howitzer?
It's a howitzer slowed down is the sound of the lances breaking. I'd hate to. This is the day I thought you would become Marlon Brando when you had to list all those names, and I had to tape them above the actor on the shield so that
I couldn't remember that.
It was like
anything.
Marlon Brando's scene in The Last Tango when he's with his wife, his dead wife, and that's really I think what you were going for.
Absolutely,
here.
And in the silences when I was forgetting my lines, the only thing you could hear was the quiet weeping of the producers.
They were terrified that this is what we were in store for, and they all came up to me and whispered to me, you have to have a talk with him. He's got to memorize his lines. In fact, I think it's just very difficult to
it's just there's no sense to the speech.
I have to thank you. I didn't think we had a chance.
Because it's a listed name.
It's a very key moment. What kind of problem do you have, I wonder?
Cut to dice.
Now, if you don't mind, I think I'll stick around and see how things turn out. Act as my herald and you receive a share of the winnings.
A share of the winnings being important because you're going to use them to further your bad habit that you have.
Exactly. Look how good-natured that horse is. Now, originally, I believed this was Son of a Preacher Man, and frankly, Brian, I hate to do this to you, but I miss it.
I know. The cast did an intervention with me, tried to get me to put it back in, but I just felt like the songs were coming just hot and heavy at that point. And I was trying to give everyone a breather. Here's Shannon Sossaman, who I always mispronounce her name even to her, so she'll forgive me, but I did say it right, Sossaman. Her first appearance on film of any sort, and...
Which is a nice thing, because you've kind of just seen her break her virginity in a way.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Her acting virginity is gone. And I'm very proud of the job she did in the film. There she goes. She's off. He's trying to find her. I don't know how she got upstairs all of a sudden, but there she is.
That's the magic of movies,
it is.
Bro.
It is.
There was a lift, or as I believe you call it, an elevator.
Yeah, yeah. You guys call trunks a boot also.
Absolutely.
It's a very strange thing. I don't know why that is. And the bonnet instead of the hood.
You call a clutch a... Do you call it a clutch?
Yeah. A clutch is a clutch. It's a universal.
The choke is...
The choke.
Right.
I think you just saw Shannon step over the dolly tracks, which we had laid down. This is Berenice from France. We thought as long as we were trying to sell all these towns as French towns, we better have a French actress in there.
She's fantastic.
Yeah. Now, this is actually... In a previous film called The Sin Eater that we tried to do together, there was a scene that happened inside a cathedral. So we never made that movie, and I was always determined that I was going to do a cathedral somewhere. So in this movie, although you don't appear in either of the scenes, we have two cathedrals. We have the Rouen Cathedral and later on the cathedral at Notre Dame.
Did it, in The Sin Eater, there was no horse in the cathedral, though?
No, there wasn't. There wasn't. And here's the fabulous Roger Ashton Griffiths, who came in to play the old bishop. I think did a very nice job. You've probably seen his face, especially people in London have probably seen his face different places.
All the time.
We have that great shot, courtesy of the mill. Thank you, Ridley Scott.
Tell me your name, woman.
And what would you do with my name, Sir Hunter? Call me a fox, for that is all.
And that's, do you think that that's all women are to men? A man is a hunter and the woman is a...
Absolutely not. Can Foxy I just lady. See Foxy Lady? Doesn't that beg another popular
it does.
Tune?
Perhaps we couldn't get the rights to that song.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Does this not shock you, ladies?
Certainly, my lord. I only laugh.
It's funny. I had to watch Shannon rehearse, audition for Sony. I had to watch her do this scene in 20 different versions of this. She actually broke your record for trying to prove
really?
To Sony that she could... That she could do the part.
She could be funny.
Yeah.
Did she have to put her nose between her toes?
No, she never did.
I think that's a benchmark.
I think you went above and beyond the comedic Call of Duty.
Thank you. Here, I'd like to point out that ring is a costume ring, and
yeah,
you can tell.
It's open on the inside. This was actually, Shannon came up with this. It's a very funny ad lib. And here we have the answering choir. It's kind of a religious experience here.
Boom.
And those splinters.
I love those splinters when they come past camera.
Yeah,
there.
A lot of them. We have balsa wood splinters kind of pre-packed in there, but also we have linguine. And that's why they stay in the air so long and they flutter.
I was told it was pasta. I was wondering whether it was small bow pasta.
Roger, Lord Mortimer, one lance.
Yeah, no, it was linguine, uncooked.
Now, that guy had to stay in Prague.
Philip Lankowski, he was a local. He was American, but he was an expatriate.
And to stay in Prague, he had to get a job. Yeah, and he needed to stay in Prague because he was in love.
He was in love with a girl. He came in to read, and he said, I'll just be honest with you. I need this part so I can stay in the country and be with the woman I love. And I said, hey, you got it. And he did a great job. I hope he's still doing parts. I hope he's still in love with her.
Oh no, this guy coming up's great.
Steve O'Donnell, he's one of the great character actors.
The prizes are bigger in the joust, the prestige as well.
Ulrich von Lichtenstein.
There he is.
Nicest man you're likely to know.
Yeah, he had a lot of difficulty getting one of these lines out, but he managed to do it.
Which one?
He kept saying, I detain you on behalf of your liege. And Heath would say, I am my liege. You have to do it over again.
Comedy cut coming up.
Big comedy cut. Off your...
I literally take the clothes off your back.
You were begging for that. You were asking for that cut.
I was asking for that.
I think, again, Mark Addy and Alan Tudyk in the background doing some really wonderful stuff.
Also, Mark Addy gloating that for once in his life, it's not him naked.
Yeah. of course, you know, Mark having done the full Monty.
Now, Peter the Pardoner and Simon the Summoner are characters from
Canterbury Tales.
There you go. Sony asked us to say that.
There's Alan delivering some pain as he does in the movie.
And that's me trying to keep my buttocks closed.
And I think it's interesting. There's a little delay there. They let him go at you for a minute before
they really slowly
come in and get him off you. When in fact, I think they could have blocked him from getting to you in the first place.
Yeah, absolutely. We played this scene very seriously, didn't we?
Yeah, I really like this scene, this moment between the two of you. There's a very kind of silent understanding here. You may understand that gambling is a sin. But we're not going to take it too seriously right now.
No.
You have some fantastic blue eyes.
Thank you very much. I think that's done in post.
Yeah. Thank you, Ridley Scott, the mill, for putting those eyes in there. He's described in the Canterbury Tales as syphilitic, and then he had the marks of rosy syphilitic marks around his lips. So we, hair and makeup, had to put them in to Simon the Summoner.
Release him.
Peter the Pardoner has what's, I think his hairstyle is called a mullet, I believe.
Yes, it's a 70s football haircut,
yeah.
Really, of sorts. Football being what people in America will refer to as soccer.
Right.
I have no idea why you call American football, bearing in mind you all use your hands.
My favorite line in the film right there, you just delivered it.
Oh.
I think also the mullet in the 70s, that it's important to point out that this is the 1370s, and the 70s never really changed. The 70s are always the 70s, so 1370, 1470, 1570.
Everybody had the same haircut.
Yeah, and the same. That's why the 70s music...
Exactly.
Maybe not such a crazy idea after all.
I have, I think, a bowl haircut in this. She's either called a bowl or a career killer.
I want to point out this man is Andy Herrick, who is the horse master who took care of Barney. His actually 10-year-old daughter was the owner of Barney.
He seemed to do everything, sort of organize the fights, organize the horses, organize catering, everything.
A very great guy.
Really lovely man.
They always used to say that he looked like a Bee Gee. And the English crew said, there's the BG on the GG. Because I guess that means horse in Britain.
GG?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you not say GG here?
No, we don't.
Oh, you're missing out. Say it now.
GG.
There you go. Fun, wasn't it?
Here's a great moment. The crowd was supposed to cheer after you finished this speech. And because they couldn't speak English and it hadn't been translated properly, when you finish, they don't cheer, and Mark Addy actually prompted them to cheer.
That's right.
We later shot a close-up of him doing it, but it became this great moment that was really unscripted.
It was slightly foolish of us not to work out they weren't going to understand a word I was saying.
Yeah.
Again, Sony not protecting you. Can you believe
this
it?
This is my favorite, one of my favorite shots of the movie right here. We slowed down a little bit. And now, of course, another 70s song. Bachman Turner Overdrive, which is actually a Canadian group. Not many people know that. But a member of the Commonwealth, nonetheless, I think you have a very strong affinity for Canadians, and they still have the Queen on their money. I don't know why that is.
Nor do I.
But there she is. You get a penny, and there's the Queen. Now, I would maintain this is like a Vincent Minnelli musical. He's taking care of business. The song says he's taking care of business. The song, like any good musical, drives the story on. It's a very nice... I just love that this... I remember when we cut this sequence, we'd run it in my trailer over and over again, and everyone would come in and we'd watch it and kind of cheer and slap ourselves on the back and be very...
Most directors are really jealous of their work once you've shot it, but and don't let you see rushes or any... Rushes are kind of short bits of film. But Brian would, in actual fact, scream. Brian would actually scream kind of the 30 minutes that he had kind of assembled on a large screen outdoors, you know, when we'd all finished and the whole crew and everybody knew what film they were making. It was, you know, it was really uplifting, and we all woke up the next day ready to behave stupidly again.
And actually a lot of members of the crew, it was good because they... After about 3 weeks of making the film, they finally realized what movie they were making. So it helped. Mm. I think it helped everybody.
Yeah.
Now here we're coming up to the introduction of Kate, the Farris. They were actually real characters from medieval times. The blacksmith's guild had a rule that if the blacksmith died and his wife had been trained in his trade, she would be able to carry on to provide for herself and the orphans. So this character, although...
Unless she remarried.
Unless she remarried. So although it seems like a... I just want to point out that modern previous idea. Blacksmith was voiced over by Alan Tudyk, but that it wasn't a fantasy that a woman actually could be a blacksmith in medieval times, although she wasn't allowed to do armor, and that's Kate's dream.
I'd also like to point out that all those last blacksmiths, those actors all went to the Pirate School of Acting.
Arr. And I remember when Laura asked me what kind of accent she should do for the film, and she's Scottish, and I said, well, be Scottish. And it was kind of an amazing thing, because she said, well, I've never been allowed to be Scottish before in a film. Mm. And I think she is the female Sean Connery.
She is. Brian has a very quick way to teach us all how to do a Sean Connery impression.
And that's to say goulash. If you say, yeah. You say the word goulash, and you're immediately image. Di Hawkins, key grip, supreme. You've worked with him in three films.
I've worked with him in three films. Di is a genius.
And they wouldn't allow me to give him an acting credit because he had a key grip credit. So I just now want to say the cat meat vendor, Di Hopkins. Now, Jocelyn hears this over and over again, these kind of cheap promises of people winning tournaments for her.
Poor girl.
But I don't think anyone ever does it the way Rufus, although he doesn't promise it. Rufus Sewell.
Rufus Sewell, ladies and gentlemen.
Proud as a feather.
Proud as a feather.
Rufus, one day we were having wine, and he said, it's the kind of a wine that steps up behind you, taps you on the shoulder, and says, hey, I knew your grandfather. And I would make him say it over and over and over again until I think he reached the point where he wanted to hit me, quite frankly.
Rufus would have parties at his house, and the poor boy would have to have a bigger per diem, should have had a bigger per diem than anybody else, because he had to bribe the police to let his parties go on.
Within 2 weeks of arriving, his parties were so legendary that even in Prague, the people that lived in Prague, they were legendary. Yeah. Now, this is where he has to explain the rules adjusting, which he complained that it was exposition. And I told him, don't think of it as exposition, think of it as sexposition. And immediately he said, all right, I know how to play that. But getting back to the parties, there would be live sex going on.
Was live sex.
And Russian mafia.
I have to stop it here because I see beer.
Okay, we're gonna shut down right
there.
But
there was live sex.
And the Russian mafia inside of 2 weeks knew where his flat was, and they would show up on a regular basis.
Yeah, it was all a bit frightening. I like the way he says coronals. How do you say that?
Coronals. It's also a little Sean Connery thing going on.
Nor have I. See, now that is your name, lady. That's a sexual illusion, isn't it? It's not an illusion, it's an illusion. Sir Hunter, an illusion.
Yeah, I believe so. Angels have no names. Shannon here has got a kind of a Audrey Hepburn look going on. I don't know if it's Roman Holiday or
Sabrina,
something like that.
Your name is Rufus Sewell's got that same look.
Yeah, I think great costumes, because they reference medieval costumes, but they take off from there and really become something I think that the audience can almost picture themselves in at a certain point.
Yeah, I mean, Caroline manages to do that the whole way through the movie, because I think seeing men in tights is alienating for anybody.
Yeah,
frankly,
it really makes a way to get past the costume and see the character. And in fact, for the guys,
Rufus is really brilliant in that scene, actually, isn't he?
Yeah, that line's great. Yeah, he really, he tears him apart, really.
Really fantastic. And this guy's brilliant.
Yeah. Working under difficult circumstances. Now, there's a typical horse that won't stay still. James Purefoy.
James Pearsex.
Sitting up there.
As he's known.
Yep.
Here comes some fool that you haven't managed to shake off.
Now, at a certain point, I was in a room by myself writing this stuff, and I thought only Paul is going to pull this off, and it's actually kind of fantastic that you can know somebody and know they can do something like this, and...
I love you.
I love you, man.
I love you, man. Our sort of image for this whole bit, especially that everybody else not sitting on a cushion, was John Lennon, who at the Royal Variety Performance, which is a command performance where the Queen writes to you and says, listen, you got to come play for me. He said, I want everybody in the cheap seats to clap your hands and the rest of you rattle your jewelry. And everybody went, no, you can't say that, I'm from the Queen, you can't. And so we just, we wanted to keep that sort of irreverence.
Yeah, and I think Chaucer at heart is a populist, really.
Absolutely. I mean, he's known as the father in the English language, but let's be frank, he did write a story at one time about a talking penis.
Yeah.
That this talking penis is being it has been charged with adultery, and he gets himself off in court. When I say gets himself off,
he liberates himself.
He liberates himself. Much better idea.
I love this moment where the sound drops out, and there's that great little creak when Rufus looks back over at Scott Handy, very underrated.
Great actor.
Brings Jermaine to life.
I used to watch Scott Handy when I was at drama school in plays in London, and he was never anything other than brilliant.
And that's really you being that kind of boxing ring announcer who goes, let's get ready to rumble.
Yeah, there was a tape made up for me of Vince McMahon.
Yeah.
And I never watched one of them. I found it far more entertaining to make Brian, who is a very soft-spoken man, do impressions for me, because it's frankly humiliating for him. And in my book, that's entertainment. And frankly, it had me nude for 5 days at that point.
This is another...
Alan being brilliant.
Brilliant, and again threatening to kick you in his own indomitable way. There's Barney getting another kiss.
Yes.
Well-deserved.
Fong does mean kick, doesn't it, Brian? Clear that up for me one more
time. It does. And as Heath always likes to point out, Barney was discovered DJing in a club called the Horseshoe in Prague.
That's right.
Is the crowd going crazy?
It was a kind of drum and bass club, I believe.
There's you having just said, do you want to touch him? I cut it out and then put the dialogue from that moment earlier in the sword fighting ring when you're leaving. And that's the kind of master manipulator that I am,
you're
I think.
Very clever.
This is a great, we're in this shot right here, we're flying the Steadicam operator on a wire over the rail. And you can't see him, but his name is Keith Sewell. And he's easily the bravest man in the crew.
His name's
Keith Sewell.
No Any relation?
No relation to Rufus.
This Liechtenstein, his technique, rudimentary style, non-existent.
Scott Handy, ladies and gentlemen.
Scott Handy being a genius. Somebody asked me what the hawk was about.
Now, yeah, we don't know exactly.
Hawking was a sport.
It was a sport, but the animal wrangler that day, among all the menagerie of animals he brought a hawk, and it just looked fantastic. And we decided to have it on Scott's arm, and he steps into the scene earlier with it on his arm, and there's no reason for it.
The thing that's amazing to note is that that hawk is so well trained. Scott had quite an itchy backside that day, and it could cling on whilst he's scratching his ass.
You would hold it by the head and use the talons as a...
You can use it as a loofah.
I still don't know what they're talking about here. Something about...
honor or something.
Yeah, something like that. It's a kind of a misplaced ideal that...
Yeah.
We're trying to revive in the film, I think. Nice. Again, in the background, Tony Burrow working away, creating a very beautiful Rouen set.
What is the actual meaning of chivalry?
Chivalry is a knife fighting term, as in shiv. And to shiv somebody, to give them the shiv, is the art of knife fighting is called chivalry. There's another great Rufus moment.
Rufus, yeah.
God, you know, I applaud him.
Yeah, absolutely. We were a little late there, so if you just rewind and watch. Oh, no, you don't rewind on a DVD.
But here's a moment, here's a line I steal from Conspiracy Theory. when he says,
how can you nick from your own work?
In conspiracy, Mel in Conspiracy Theory says, love gives you wings. In the cab, when he's talking about what love is, and he says, Geronimo, love gives you wings. And I decided if one Australian's going to say it, all Australians have to say it.
Absolutely.
And again, here's the great foot acting of Alan Tudyk.
Alan Tudyk, who's about to sit up and say,
Tansy cakes.
Tansy cakes.
Which is a medieval cake. Although none of us could ever manage to get a hold of one. And women do weaken the heart. I believe that's true. That's kind of the Burgess Meredith. Alan and Mark both alternate with their Burgess Meredith kind of get in there and get him rock. Get in a moment.
Rocky.
There's the pillow.
Rocky.
There's the pillow. Just the vestiges remain.
I was recently in Philadelphia doing the press tour for this and saw the steps that Rocky ran up. And apparently there's always some tourist jumping up and going, Adrian, Adrian.
Yeah, yeah. The funny thing is I almost at one point dedicated the film to the movie Rocky because I actually really love it. But I didn't. I decided to keep all the credit for myself.
Good.
And any kind of anything that... Any similarities that people see between this story and Rocky are purely coincidental. I did not steal anything. This is the only scene in the film shot in London, Pinewood Studios.
I'd just like to point out that we've both got a beer, so I think everybody else probably should as well.
Yeah. There you go. Here's Rufus entering the stadium on his beautiful black horse. They're a Czech breed called the Claude Rebay, and we're very happy to have them. This is a moving camera across the actors that the kids really enjoy. It's got that MTV kind of feel to it. Heath has this thing that he does a couple of times in the movie, almost like a bobsledder, when he closes his eyes and imagines the run before he goes. You'll notice the scarf that she's holding in the previous scene is not embroidered, but this scarf is, and the reason why was the previous scene was shot later and someone had stolen the scarf, so we had to fake it.
Damn it.
And I urge all people not to steal.
Don't. In fact, you know, people that steal and thieve, they both mean the same thing, by the way. But people that do, if you cut their hands off, and you sewed it in the middle of their face, they'd never do it again, would they?
I bet it'd be the last time they did that.
That'd learn them.
And that's part of that whole chivalric, because you would use the knife to cut off their hands, so it's part of the chivalric
code.
Yeah. This is the kind of getting ready to go kind of bit. A lot of second unit stuff here. I was very happy to see all this stuff. It's kind of, most directors don't want to talk about their second unit. They kind of want to pretend that they shot everything in the movie, but I will right now say I owe anything I am after this point to Alan Graf.
Yeah, we, frankly, you were hardly ever there.
He's called the big man because he's an offensive tackle. He's also called the pizza man because he delivers. And he also terrifies the actors, and they won't go, once they were on second unit, they won't go back.
That's true.
He treats everybody like a stuntman, no matter who they are.
That's right.
There's a great nostril snort from Barney there that I really enjoy.
He has his own agent and his own acting coach.
Now you come running into the pit stop here, and I have no idea why.
I'm pulling the wrong rein that made Barney bite me. Because I know nothing about horses.
I think there's a kind of brilliant bit here where he compares William to an anvil. William compares him to a hammer. And for those of you who aren't familiar with the whole blacksmith trade, those two things go together in a big way.
Yeah.
It's a way of keeping Kate alive in the movie, I think.
Clever.
That's called a rear back. Horses are trained to do that. And this is, again, Carter Burwell's score. Whatever you think of the rock and roll, I love it, but Carter, there's no argument. He's a genius. There she is, watching the action, hoping that her armor weld is going to hold up. It's one of my favorite shots in the film. And actually, getting this shot was a nightmare. We tried to get it 8 different times.
Why?
We had bad weather. We had people passing out in the stands. We had anything that could go wrong. Every time we tried to do that shot would go wrong. Now, Rufus is all business here. That helmet goes down and it's all over. He doesn't, our boy doesn't have a chance here. Again, Carter Burwell.
Also, the way that you show that our boy doesn't have a chance is he's about to ride in normal time and Rufus rides in slow motion.
Yeah, Rufus has become a machine. He's more machine than man, where our boy here is just a man. So there you got slow motion. Regular speed, slow motion.
Regular speed?
I think you get the idea, but that's slow motion.
Those jousting rinks were only about, arenas were only about 30 foot long. And
yeah.
Actually, in the movie, it turns out they're about 500 feet long.
It takes about a year to get across.
Yeah.
Here's Lee Conwell, who did a fantastic job as the little William.
From Dublin, doing an English accent amazingly.
I just want to point out that the studio wanted him to wear blue contact lenses, but
right.
we didn't think that was right to do to a little kid. I mean, I'm sorry, they wanted him to wear brown contact lenses. He had blue eyes, but I don't think anyone ever questions that he's not the young William. And again, Chris Kazanoff, I think a very, very fine actor. I think I mentioned earlier, in the very first thing I ever directed was an episode of Tales from the Crypt. And I was scared out of my mind, and he really got me through it. And when it came time to cast this part, there was no one else I wanted but Chris.
How long did it take to get that shot of the Lance picking up that?
It took about 3 hours until we finally dug a hole under it so that the guy could stick the lance down into the hole.
Now that visor kept falling down, didn't it?
Yeah. I mean, Rufus never knew at what point that visor was going to snap down and maybe take his nose off. There you guys are doing your own stunts once again.
Once more.
Alan always being game to get knocked down in any capacity.
He loves it.
Yeah. It's contact. He loves the contact. It's like that Peter Gabriel song, I think.
My lady, I believe this is yours.
Now, Rufus's armor plating on his left side there is because that's the side that's going to take the lance hit. And so his head hides behind that.
Great bit of comedy acting coming up from Alan Tudyk.
Yeah, a great kind of... There's also a great moment you'll watch Paul kiss Scott Handy here. Right there.
In the wide.
I said, surprise Scott. I didn't know what you were going to do, and you gave him a kiss. And unfortunately, we couldn't use it.
Alan Tudyk. Being brilliant. There you go. I present
to you your champion. Again, there's Philip Lenkowski staying in Prague for the girl he loves.
You love him for that.
Doesn't get any better than that.
Now, I would have said not in public, please.
This line I stole from the Bible, of all places, and I forget which king it was. But it was the king who threw Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the furnace. Those words, you have been weighed, measured, and found wanting, appeared mysteriously on the wall of his castle as a harbinger that God was coming to take care of him. Here's again a total lack of respect for the prizes.
Now, bearing in mind he just won the sword, why has he got a little man jousting on a horse, gold man jousting on a gold horse?
That's a good question, and I think... at the end of the credits, we're going to have the prop man's phone number
right,
so that people can call and ask him that question. Now, this is a great literary allusion here.
There's that mullet.
And I was an English major in college, and this moment is really for every English major that ever had to read Chaucer. That's your line, I was naked for a day.
Thank you.
And I think that I should be thanked for having an ego that was such... that I could allow you to change my words.
Yeah, that's true. Brian did have the bravery and courage to leave the camera rolling, even if you were messing around, and also the bravery and courage to come up to you and go, you're being bad, stop it, you're ruining my movie.
And I think the key thing is the stamina to do all those things.
Absolutely.
There's Kate. She's not, you know, she's not going to get pushed around.
The rest of us will pack camp.
And I think this is really the point in the film where Heath is really becoming the knight and leaving his squires behind.
Yeah. During the movie, we forced Alan Tudyk to eat some very odd things, and at the moment, he's eating one of them, which is a sausage.
It's kind of a Czech salami, which after about 12 takes, I think is probably, he's had his fill.
It can get quite tiresome.
Yeah. Now, people comment, or they may comment, that the actual outfit that Heath wears later in the sequence has very little to do with the tent that Mark is actually cutting up to make the costume
for. And the point is what?
The point is that he is an incredible sewer, an embroiderer, and...
People that point that out, I won't be going for a drink with. I don't know about you, Bron.
No, not at all. Let the magic be the magic, I think,
exactly.
Is the key thing.
I will tell my lady.
People bowed back then. I think that's nice.
Do you not bow here?
No.
Oh, we all bow in England.
No, I know in Canada also, because they got the Queen there on the money and stuff.
We bow, and at 4:15 we have tea every day. Entire nation.
This night I'll always remember, because it marked the arrival of Mike Proudfoot, A camera operator supreme.
Genius.
Into the film. So thank
big
you, Mike.
Big Rolling Stones fan.
Big Rolling Stones fan. In fact, I wrote the lyrics for some unknown reason to... Wild Horses, and
he wore them in his hat.
He wore them in his hat band. It was my favorite line, which was "You made me." I forget what it was. Something about she suffered from a dull aching pain.
You made me suffer a dull aching pain, and now it seems you want me to feel the same.
Yeah, no, I watched you suffer a dull aching pain.
There you go.
And now you would have me feel the same. And Mike wore that in his hat for a couple of months. I have no idea why.
He's just strange like that.
Oh, and you can do better, can you?
No, that's Kate whistling, which she does very well. Later in the film, she does a two-fingered whistle.
She's a good whistler. She, Laura Fraser can't spit, though, I believe.
Yeah.
And later on in the movie, there was supposed to be a spitting scene, but Laura couldn't do it. She just couldn't cut the mustard when it came to spitting.
No. It's one of those things where sometimes there's something you can't do, and you overcompensate with something else. So in her case, it was whistling, I think.
Yeah.
This is nighttime.
Five, six, seven, change part.
That's all I really have to say about this sequence. Again, Mark Addy, there's a tent. It looks like the tent to me, really, now that I think of it.
Looks exactly like the tent.
You're not going to wear your hair like that, are you?
Now, that's a reference to the fact that Heath was supposed to have silver hair in the following sequence. Of course, Kate has said you're not going to wear your hair like that, but in fact, that's exactly how he's going to wear his hair.
Entirely, because he's a man of his word.
Yeah.
This is actually shot on an ice rink, isn't it?
Yeah.
Underneath all that stone, pretend stone flooring is a communist ice rink.
Yeah, and ice hockey being a very big sport in the Czech Republic. This is also all our cathedral sets are this set. Now this is, again, it's another Bible reference here about God stopping the sun at Gibeon to give Joshua more time to defeat the Amorites. And I'm just trying to prove to my grandmother, who's no longer with us, God rest her, that I did pay attention in Sunday school. And this is a prime example of that.
I would like to point out to my grandparents that I paid absolutely no attention at Sunday school, which is why I don't have the faintest idea what you're talking about.
I don't understand.
Joshua, of course, being kind of the general of Moses.
Was he?
So he's really John Derek from the Ten Commandments. Also a stonemason. That's a good movie for guys without their shirts on, I think.
Big movie, yeah. Actually. Big movie for...
Yeah, Stuart Hopps, choreographer. I met him in the lobby of a hotel in London, and we were waiting for the producer to come, one of the producers. And I said to him, so what do you have in mind, Stuart? And he started twirling, and he danced away from me all the way across the lobby. And the whole place just shut down while they watched him dance through the lobby. And by the time he had danced back over to me, he had the job. So there you have it.
Did he have the same haircut at that point?
No, that is an enforced haircut.
Right.
That is not his haircut of choice.
Is that right? Because I would have thought that would have been reason enough to not employ him.
Yeah. He has gold leaf in his hair. You see the little gold spikes on his head. Again, that's a tent that he's wearing. I think that's quite obvious. And in the first social situation he was in when they laughed at him, there was no help for him, but now Jocelyn comes forward and helps him out.
There you go. There are no wooden toggles, though, are there?
No, the wooden toggles are worn on the inside.
Ah, clever. Clever, clever, clever.
Yeah.
These medieval fashions.
Yeah.
This man has the shiniest forehead in cinematic history.
We use him as a reflector. To help light, when he turns, he helps to light Heath and Shannon. Right there as he turns.
Bang! Right,
bouncing the light off his head. Of course, I'm very proud that David Bowie himself allowed us to split the tracks on Golden Years and make for a smooth transition from the old to the new dance.
Did he?
Again, it's one of those things where I didn't know that they didn't dance to David Bowie in medieval times. And as stupid as I felt about the Queen at the opening, I really, really...
How would you know? How's anybody to know?
Yeah. I mean, he never seems to age.
Nope.
Looks the same now as he did in the 60s, so why
not further?
You can hear him singing, kind of doing that,
Angel.
Probably. Angel, yeah. Of course, I originally had Casey and the Sunshine Band Get Down Tonight slotted for this spot. And, Heath met me in Prague one day on the street, and he said he had a better idea, and this was it, and I think it was.
That's another example of your sort of courage.
Yeah.
To take on new ideas.
And going back to stamina, I think, being the key thing. It was followed by a fantastic dance sequence. I mean, the riot sequence outside, which was done to Casey and the Sunshine Band, but unfortunately it was cut, and I'm still waiting to see if the studio comes through the cash to buy the song so I can use it in the deleted scene sequence. So if you're watching the deleted scenes and you're watching the food riot, if Casey and the Sunshine Band isn't there, get a recording and Get Down Tonight and play it over Rufus throwing the food out, because it will take on a whole new meaning. But hopefully they came through like they promised, and it's on the track.
Because in the original, there's a scene between Rufus and a monk where Rufus complains of being deaf to the tones.
Yeah, he talks about he doesn't understand music. It sounds like children fighting to him, as opposed to what his parties sounded like, the infamous parties of Rufus Sewell.
Which sounded like the last years of the Roman Empire.
Yeah, it didn't sound like children fighting. It sounded like grown people getting down tonight, I believe, is the best way to put it. Now, again, blacksmiths are supposed to do that. They're supposed to hit and then hit the anvil, and I don't know why, and I wish I could explain it. But I'm sure there are metallurgists out there who know.
I think it's a tick more than anything.
This, I just want to point out that no money exchanged hands for this shot. So anyone who thinks I'm cynical and wearing Nike sneakers, it's not true. Paul's checking my feet right now.
Yeah.
I think he can confirm that they are not Nikes, are they?
Those are indeed not Nikes. They have no swoosh.
What? Yep.
I don't know.
I'm wearing Camper, which are a brilliant Spanish company, and if they'd like to send me any shoes, I'd really appreciate that.
But just as strong.
What are these?
The marks of my trade. Should another knight admire the armor?
Now, that line, should another knight admire the armor, of course, Phil Knight, the founder of Nike, is in fact the knight who admired the armor and bought the armor. I mean, picked up on the slogan. And after one of the screenings, one of the Sony executives came up to me and said, what a brilliant pun. And I didn't want to let on that I didn't know what he was talking about. And then he explained the whole Phil Knight. And I just kind of smiled and said, yeah, that's how clever I am. Now, in the script, as Heath gets on this horse, I said that he was like Montgomery Clift in Red River. And Montgomery Clift's practiced for actually weeks and weeks so that he could just walk and step into the stirrup and get on the horse. And that's what Heath did as well. So there we have it.
There wasn't a box, though.
There was no box.
You promised me.
Well, a little box.
Okay.
A Although in America, in filmmaking, we call them apple boxes, but for some unknown reason, the British call them Paganinis.
I haven't the smallest idea.
Yeah. So it's an apple box or a Paganini, depending on what side of the continent or what side of the ocean you're from. This is one of our stunt horses. He's a Spanish horse. He came all the way from Spain to do this stunt.
This was meant to happen.
Yeah. And he's trained. The guy pulls back on the rails, and the horse will throw himself over. And we got a balsa wood fence there, of course, so no one gets hurt. And kind of as gruesome as that looks, he's fine and enjoys doing it, in fact. There he goes.
So at this point, I'd like to point out that America hadn't been discovered yet, except by the indigenous population that already lived there, obviously.
Yeah. Again, I was not aware of that. In my research hadn't revealed that.
People just don't help you, do they, Brian?
No, they don't. And, you know, an entire crew read the script. They saw the allusions to 70s rock, and no one had the decency to come up to me and say they didn't have that music back then. This is what we call a five shot. again, Mike Proudfoot, God bless him, he said to me at a certain point when we were trying to get across the idea of friendship, and he said, shoot the world and let the audience decide what they want to look at. So, again, if you watch this more than once, keep an eye on Alan and Mark and everyone else and see what kind of really precious things they're doing, even when they're not speaking.
That you didn't have the decency to cover in a closer.
No. That's time. Time is money, and I'm not going to spend any of that. Here, Scott Handy had a funny stunt that he did where he ran out with the flag and tripped and fell, which is why his face is so flushed there. But we opted to cut it out, and I thank Scott for all the times he fell on the ground to no avail. Now, if anyone understands the logic there, I'm just trying to push the story ahead as quick as I can. Somehow these guys know exactly what's going on, although I have no idea.
Now there is a real historical inaccuracy here, and I'm not talking about the music. The inaccuracy is that, in actual fact, Geoffrey Chaucer had worked for the Black Prince before this point, and therefore would have been easily recognizable.
Yeah, in reality, he had spied for the Black Prince in the French court, and was later to go on to work for the Black Prince. Died a few years after this, and John of Gaunt, who was his brother, became Chaucer's patron and actually paid for the first illuminated version of the Canterbury Tales.
Is that right?
That's true. Here you are. We flip-flop the film here so that you're looking towards the Black Prince instead of looking back at your mates.
Yeah, I noticed that.
Now, look, the Black Prince has come here to compete. He's not fooling around, so he can appreciate something like this. That's one of my favorite moments.
Lance? Yeah, me too.
Sean Connery would be proud of that.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, I'd just like to say giddy aunt. Yeah. Not used enough as an expression.
No. And giddy aunt actually means to kick.
It's one of my lines, and I feel a huge burden of responsibility to bring that back into common usage.
Let's get ready. Anyone at United Artists, the Broccoli family, as this helmet gets off, we're going to try to give you an idea of who this man should someday be playing. This man is James Bond. Someone wake up.
He is James Bond.
That is Sean Connery. I'm going to shoot you in the back, James Bond, right there. And if you do get the part, I hope you remember us.
Yeah, we want 10%.
Yeah. Well, it happens.
Yes, it does.
Good luck with the tournament.
And you also.
The winner of the Mounted Joust and tournament champion, Ulrich von Liechtenstein.
Yeah! Again, face painting, apparently not around back then. Like, no one would step forward and let me know that.
Really?
Again, Heath's total lack of respect for his prizes.
Adamar withdrew.
Sir Ulrich.
Now, some people have asked us why he's in a bad mood, and in case you hadn't listened to the dialogue, He won't be champion until Adhemar, until he defeats Adhemar, and Adhemar was not there.
Exactly.
There you are, the voice of reason.
Thank you. Could you explain to me why she's wearing a cone on her head?
Again, this is one of her great costumes. Kind of reflects the fight they're about to have.
And a rose never knocked a man off a horse either, did it?
And most girls are quite silly, I think. Don't you think so?
No.
Now, speaking of watching the world, I very much enjoy your reaction here. When he looks to you for approval, there you go. You did good, but I'm disgusted with you. You've blown it.
Alan Tudyk being brilliant.
Yep.
There you go.
And again, no one would come forward and tell me that that was anachronistic. I thought they said that all the time. Again, Carter Burwell, brilliant kind of Arabian Nights score going on there.
Look at this. I love this. It takes the slack and then pulls him off.
You think he's just going to fall, but it's worse. Oh, a second unit. I want to show you first. There's first unit right there. We matched right in. Now, you're constantly arriving. I don't know who you go to talk to find out all these things.
I go to talk to Todd Black. I don't want to go into it.
You do it here, you do it earlier, the previous scene, and you do it later during the parade. You seem to have this kind of snitch. My whole theory is that Chaucer goes off and talks to Huggy Bear anytime he needs to know anything.
He gets the word from the street.
Yeah. That's right. Huggy Bear, of course, being the mysterious character in Starsky and Hutch who seems to know everything. Now, here's a herald out on the battlefield, probably the last place he belongs.
Yeah. And here's Rufus being annoyingly brilliant again.
Yeah. There he is. Scott now does not know if he's going to die or not, basically. It's that old thing about don't kill the messenger, I think. And these are supposed to be the medieval sports pages here. Now, good cue coming up as Rufus lifts his head. We're about to hear it. It's coming up. You can hear the bugs buzzing. And now Scott knows he's about to die. Don't take it out on the messenger, right, Paul?
Never shoot the messenger.
Yeah. Jeff. William. Write a letter. Now, this is actually one of my... if we can get serious, if we can get down for a minute.
Okay, I'm with you.
This is my favorite bit in the whole movie, because to me, in this scene, that you really find out it's a bunch of broken-hearted people all on the road together, and they've all been kind of damaged by love. Say something about her breasts. Except maybe Alan.
I just realized that for the last 5 minutes I've been nodding and that doesn't work.
You could. But nodding in a very, very fine way.
Thank you.
Now, I think you refused to go through calligraphy lessons here.
Yeah.
So we were forced to use someone else's hand.
It just seemed an entirely dull thing to go and do.
And I was under a lot of pressure from different department heads begging me to get Paul to go through his calligraphy lessons. And all you really seemed to care about was that you had a little bit of ink between your fingernails.
Yeah. I have seen the new movie. It works.
Can you talk about the research that you go through to play a writer?
Right, well, what you do is you wait for Brian Helgeland or any writer that you're working with to send you a package of research material, which includes a photograph of, a photostat, no, they're called photocopies now, of a picture of Chaucer, and it transpires that Chaucer was, in actual fact, an enormously fat, bald, bearded dwarf, and I'm clearly none of those things, so I did what any self-respecting actor would do, which is throw any pretensions to doing any research whatsoever straight out the window and hope for the best, really.
I think you can say that on the one hand, but I think when people watch you, there is an enormously fat, bald dwarf inside somewhere
just
trying to get out.
Just waiting to get out.
Yeah.
No, you're right.
I think this is very clever. We're moving the camera here, the way the kids, that MTV generation enjoy.
They love it. Like,
and here's a brilliant transition. Very clever.
Oh, look at that.
That's the kind of elegance that I demand in my filmmaking.
I like it. I'd just like to point out that Mark Addy was brilliant about 3 minutes earlier on.
Yeah.
Now, Laura Fraser being brilliant.
Now, Laura, if you remember what we said about a Faris earlier, that the widow could continue being a blacksmith when she says, "My husband, God rest him," that, in fact, is her husband, the blacksmith. It is what gets me through the day and especially the night.
the hope that after you're gone from
the funny thing is I wrote the letter, and it's, if you actually sent someone this letter, they would laugh you kind of off the face of the earth. But in a movie, I think it works pretty well.
With all the love that I possess.
Big point coming up.
Yeah.
What do you mean, Auron?
Dun, dun, dun. So, apparently, part of this movie is about identity, isn't it?
Yeah, I think so. I think it might be.
Yeah. Now, we had sent Alan home because he had done all his stuff, and he had to work early the next morning. So Shannon, in this shot, when we dolly in on her, is reacting to me, and as she smiles, I think it's because I cross my eyes, which is actually something I do quite often, but it worked in this case, and I'm very proud that I'm acting in the film, which is off camera. Now, this is the brilliant David Schneider.
David Schneider is a great writer and a great comedian in London. For some reason, he's nearly completely cut out of the movie.
Yeah. the idea was that there was
he is a genius.
He seems smarter than me, so I had to cut him out.
But brilliant idea.
It was a running gag where in whatever town they were in, he was there selling a relic. And unfortunately, that's really all that remains of a very brilliant performance, except for the missing scenes in DVD.
That's right. Now, I think if you look closely, you'll see that I'm in actual fact wearing the clothes of Huggy Bear from this point in the movie onwards.
Yeah, this is we like to call this his Pulse Pimp Jacket. Now, this is maybe the oldest joke in the history of movies, one man kissing another man.
It's always funny.
And it works every single, I don't know what it is, it works every time you tell it, and it didn't fail me here. Come on, give it to me. Audience starts to laugh about 10 seconds before it. And
there you go, bingo.
As the British say, it works a treat.
It works a treat.
Yes. Why don't you guys just say cool? That was cool.
Yeah. I don't know.
Now we're about to come up to Paul speaking some French. He says 50, which is 50 in French, because they're betting 50 gold florins.
There you go. Also, in a second, you're about to see me do a Robert De Niro impression in French.
A little bit of Taxi Driver, I think.
It happened entirely by mistake, but Brian decided to keep it in.
The band, we never showed the band. You can see them playing back there over the guy's shoulder. But we always were convinced, because of lies that were told to us, that either Keith Richards or Robert Page and Jimmy Plant were going to come in and play the band. And they never did. So that's why we never shot the bandstand.
I think Keith Richards was alive during the medieval period. Well, at least looks like he was.
Yeah, whereas David Bowie was born just sort of during the beginning of the Renaissance. Robert De Niro, there you go. Also some more an expatriate British actor, an expatriate American actor, and a Czech actor playing the French squires. What I think is so interesting is everyone thinks that this group is from Gelderland, and they're talking about whether an Englishman or a Frenchman will win the championship.
Yeah, it's very odd. I'd just like to point out that Alan said he's that kicking close.
He's that kicking close, yes. Which didn't actually happen until 1378, the Pope being French. But the Pope may be French, but Jesus is English. I'm going to get free beer every time I go into a pub in England for that line, I think, that the Pope is French, but Jesus is English. Now, what are these, Paul?
These are football chants and...
You mean soccer chants?
I mean football chants. No, these are soccer chants that we made up on the day because we were all, I think, as you can see, clearly drunk.
Now, this shot is kind of an interesting shot. It's all done in one, basically. And a lot of people said it was bold of me to do, to play a three-minute scene in a single shot. As beautiful as it is, I think most directors wouldn't have had the stamina. I would have gone in for the close shots. But I think now I can tell the truth that I had run out of time to shoot this set, and had the studio executives were screaming at me to get out of there. And it saved the production $135,000 if I got out of there that night. And so I said, well, let's
do it. Is that right?
Yeah, and let's do it in one. and then I'll just shoot two close-ups at the very end. And I feel the same. I saved $130,000, proved my stamina, and did a great, what I feel is a great master.
It is a piece of genius, Brian, and will go down in the annals of cinematic history.
And again, those stained glass windows were blue screen, so we have Ridley Scott once again, and the Mill Film Company in London to thank for that. I think in a lot of ways, Ridley was with us every step of the way while we were making this film.
He was, in a way.
Really? Yes.
Really? It's Flanks.
Yes.
I wish to hear poetry.
Again, $130,000 saved because I'm way back, but a mile away
from
them.
Stop it. Stop it with the references to your saving.
We were back. Actually, we were only about 30 yards away. The crew were all wearing crash helmets and face shields in case anything went wrong here in this dangerous sequence that we're shooting at
this
time.
It's a very edgy moment.
Anything could have happened. There's people walking by. Someone could have tripped and lunged into the camera crew. We had spotters making sure that nothing went wrong here.
Sets are a very dangerous place to work.
Did you see those flames, those open flames
go
by?
Anything could happen there.
Yeah, yeah.
It's, you know, a film set is a disaster waiting to happen.
Yeah.
And in this case, I think...
the fact that we all made it out of this scene alive, I think, is a miracle.
It is.
Especially when it starts tracking back the other way, because we don't know what's happened to the track that the camera's on as we've left it. Anything could have happened.
Anything can happen, especially if Di Hopkins is operating
that
dolly.
One of the tricks is that the Indians like to come in and move the tracks so that the dolly will fall off the tracks and slow down the progress of the dolly tracks. I think this actor was a little bit disappointed. He didn't know about the doing it all in one. And at the end of the night, he asked me if we had forgotten to do his close-up. And I had to tell him, in fact, we hadn't forgotten to do his close-up.
We just hadn't.
We just hadn't. And now we're in close. Because when you say things like, I will not lose, and you do not love me.
You need a close-up.
That's a tip to all the kids out there who are hoping to make films. If someone has a line like, I love you till the end of time, you better be on their face when they say it.
You better get close.
And that's why you have to be kind of at your best at any given time.
That's right.
I don't really know what that means exactly. This is the Vltava River substituting for the Seine. You apparently are walking on water at that opening.
But no. Again, the magic of movies, ladies and gentlemen.
I think the harasser of Parasser is a bit of a stretch.
I would also like to point out that the line he gave them hell at La Rochelle was written by a man called Daniel Fredenberg, who's a great friend of mine and a fine actor himself, and felt I need an extra rhyming couplet, and he came up with one
and
at the last moment.
There was a sort of Damocles hanging over me the entire production, that whenever Paul was unhappy with a line, and I couldn't come up with a better line, that you would immediately call Daniel and set him to work to undermine me.
Yeah. It's a way, anybody who is thinking of becoming an actor, it's a very good way of getting your director on the back foot. Frighten them on the first day.
Now, I got this when I was doing research. I read a book called The Book of Courtly Love, and they said that you have to act against your normal character. You have to act against yourself to prove your love. So this is right out of the troubadour's code of courtly love in, I think, 14th century medieval France.
Troubadours were men who went around singing songs about sex, basically.
Yeah, sex. In fact, at Rufus's parties, when you'd enter at the ground floor, the troubadours were there to greet you. And sometimes sing about certain members of past parties that had
been there.
Yeah,
and
merited song lyrics about them.
Dozen told me I should lose to prove my love.
Again, three very nice reactions there. Pick which one you want to watch.
Watch Alan. There you go.
In that one single gesture, I feel that Alan Tudyk really blames all women for the ills of men across the world.
It's probably quite revealing about Alan's own nature.
Yeah. There is no room to screw up with Alan.
No.
Here's a key line. You notice we cut in. He says, I love her. We've got to get in close.
Now, I believe Sony wanted to go back and reshoot that with the visor up.
Yeah, because a key line like that, the visor should be up. While I maintained, comedically, saying that line with a helmet on was funnier. I think we'll let the audience decide that one. Those flags going up are very much like the fish going up in the chariot race during Ben-Hur.
I would now like to kind of celebrate the catching work of Laura Fraser there.
In fact, when I came up with the idea that she would catch that, I had to ask her like an idiot if she could do it, assuming because she was a girl that she couldn't. She proceeded to catch it over and over and
every
over
time,
again.
Didn't drop it once.
And each time give me kind of a disgusted look afterwards, like, is that how's that for a girl catching the end of a lance? Which I believe is tipped with a coronal.
That's right. Laura Fraser has actually been catching lances all her life.
Yeah. She was kind of raised that way.
Yep. Put him down. Now, this machine actually is real, I believe it or
yeah.
not.
Yep.
Believe it or not.
It's to relocate dislocated shoulders and knees. Take key losses. Who knows? You could make
the semis. Even the finals. Well, at least the armor's proven itself.
Now, we're all slightly upset at William because we're about to lose an enormous amount of money.
Yeah.
If he loses.
Again, you're giving him kind of a rub down while his shoulder is dislocated. I don't think that's medically correct. I'm not sure.
No, I just like to give men rub downs when they dislocate any bit of them.
That's
blasphemous.
That's my
Ooh, I love that bit.
It's a nice sound effect. We worked hard on the dubbing stage to get that.
Who did you make dislocate their arm?
I don't have an answer. I wish I had a funny answer for that, but right. I don't.
I like to set you up with gags that have no punchline.
it's like volleyball, really. Usually you expect the guy to set the ball up so you can spike it, but in that case, I think you set it up, and I was getting ready to spike it. You stepped up behind and pulled my shorts down. And Berenice Bayo, right there. You can hear David Schneider in the background. We took one of his voiceovers and threw it in the background there. There's Vlad the Impaler is the Duke here. And how I hate her. Again, Sly and the Family Stone. I thought 1,500, 1,400, what's the difference? But apparently...
There is one.
Yeah.
Nor do I, but they understand us.
Again, it's one of those actor moments you decided not to look at each other until the very end, which is comedy. Don't ask me why.
That's comedy. Also, I'd like to point out that Brian wrote that maybe not you line 5 seconds before we went, which is the kind of superhero writer that he is.
Again, stamina.
Stamina.
It's really, this sequence is really the battle between the sexes, I think. It's kind of Bobby Riggs, Billie Jean King, that kind of thing going on, I think. Everyone's always waiting for this thing to turn over to make sure there's no head in it. And you can see there that there isn't.
48, 49, and 50. Thank you very much, gentlemen. It's been excellent.
That jacket had some interesting kind of embossed leatherwork on it. And, Carolyn Harris, the costume designer, came to you and asked what you'd like written on it. You want to talk about that?
I wanted the words "big pants" written on. For the Americans among the audience, pants isn't nearly as funny as it is in England because pants means underwear in my country, and I happen to think underwear is very funny.
And therefore, big underwear being
big
even funnier.
Big underwear is enormously funny.
And it was written in Italian. For some unknown reason.
And, yeah.
Grande, what was it? Do you remember?
Pantalone.
Yeah.
Pantalone?
Something like that. Well. And now my line was, bed her well, my lord, bed her well. And you changed it to bed him well, my lady. Which I think, in a weird sort of way, completely changes your attitude, the meaning of the line. And it's kind of nice.
You're very sweet, but you actually changed the line before. It's nice of you for lying, though.
Jocelyn, your prize.
My prize.
Again, we're coming up to one of those key plot points again.
I'm not worthy of a prize.
Here it comes.
Then who is?
Nicely segued there.
My right. maid tells me that sometimes you're varlet.
My maid tells me that sometimes your varlets call you William. You'll have to rewind to watch where that happens. If at all.
Yeah.
Key moment. Now he has a chance to say no and deny his identity, and he doesn't.
Yes,
key moment.
So.
She doesn't really want to know any more than that. She just wants to know he's not lying to her.
But she wants to get into his trousers.
As opposed to his pants. Being PG-13, we never really quite know what goes on here.
No.
Although Rufus does later talk about winning horses, prizes, and women. And we feel... He may be referring to this moment, we're not sure.
I imagine that after this scene, they maybe play chess or something, friendly game of cards.
Yeah, yeah.
He's about to be very funny and good, brilliant.
William, this pain is my doing.
There you go. Excellent.
Always a big laugh. Although my father, played by Chris Kazanoff, his father, that is.
He taught me to take the bad with the good.
Now, I think it's clear that they are about to, in fact, play dominoes or chess or some board game.
Parcheesi.
Yeah.
Backgammon.
Yeah, they could play backgammon.
Twister.
No. Twister was invented till a couple of years later.
Yeah, Twister actually was around 14. Actually, Twister was a game that Christopher Columbus discovered in the New World and brought back with him. So, here we are in the middle of still water, trying to pass it off as the River Thames. With gigantic fog machines working about a mile away and just praying that the fog's going to roll in at the right point.
And it did.
Now, later on, you see Heath. In a few moments, you see Heath and Mark as young men together. And if Mark hasn't been home for 5 years and Heath hasn't been home for 12, shouldn't they both have not been home for 12?
Good point.
And someone brought that up to me, and I said, earlier in the love scene when Mark talks about someone broke his heart, that's when it happened. He left the group, went back to London, and
stopped with her.
And that's why he's only been gone for 5. Briefly left Heath, left the William character. Now again, you pointed out at the beginning that we saw I forget his name now.
Hector.
Sir Hector, without his beard, looking a little bit different, and now we see him in the past.
Looking dashing.
Yeah. There's a discrepancy there that I really can't explain.
Now, the ferryman is also, I believe, the gaffer.
Yeah.
Sir Hector?
He is. He is. David Gray.
David Gray.
And,
great guitarist and singer from Scotland.
He's the rigger. The key rigger. And David also, Di being named David, Di Hopkins, so we had to call one Di and one David, so we wouldn't be calling them both David all the time. Although they kind of arrived with those rules, so I don't know why I'm pretending to have come up with them. That might be a thing we might have to re-record right there. I'm not sure.
So, that whole little sequence.
This actor is Nick Brimble.
Brilliant.
Yeah, brilliant. And you may remember him as Little John in Robin Hood.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. Got a strong arm? The irony with Little John always being that he was big.
Clever.
And they called him Little John.
Another example of fine medieval humor.
Yeah, because that's the kind of thing that they don't do anymore. Like little Paul, little Brian.
No.
We're both big guys.
Yeah.
And that's why it's so wrong, really, that I tried to get that rock music back there, because we didn't carry things like that forward, so why bring other things back?
I don't know. If you're going to start something.
Finish it. Actually, that line, I'll show you marvels you haven't not yet dreamed of. Nick Brimble wrote that line.
Did he?
Yep. I said something like, you're going to see some really cool stuff. Again, I was lost. You know, no one would stop me at that point.
You see, it's, that touch that you have for medieval language.
The irony being that if you actually went back to medieval times, the British aristocracy spoke French, and the peasants spoke a version of English that we probably wouldn't recognize.
Yeah.
So anyone that wants to split historical hairs can think about that, I think.
Yeah, they can put that in their pipe and smoke it.
Yeah. It's really movie convention that we're fighting. Also with the music, the instruments of an orchestra having not existed for 300 years until after the date this film was made, and certain people have insisted to me that it should be orchestral.
Yeah. And they cite Excalibur as an example, the film Excalibur, which has music by Wagner.
Yeah.
In it, and of course, Wagner was writing around about the 19th century.
Exactly. So it's just sort of I think it's the naysayers that we've really drawn the line against.
Exactly.
And that we've really been kind of fighting against our whole lives. Boys are back in town, Paul.
Thin Lizzy were a band actually from the 13th or 14th century. I can't remember.
Yeah, this is the one time I got it right. Here we see Cedric, one of our French stuntmen, right there. And I think it's a song that you almost beat me, not defeated me, but almost actually struck me.
Yeah.
You weren't included in the parade.
Yeah, I'm not in the parade, and I'm slightly hurt. The music just fades out, and then I come on, and
you can just before that, you actually see Mark Addy puff up with pride, literally. We're coming up to one of Alan Tudyk's, another one of his great moments. there's a child up here on the stocks, which are the same stocks that William, as a boy, once watched the parade happen from. And that little boy is the same boy that in the later sequence comes up and hits William in the head. And I think it shows the price of fame, really.
Yeah.
it's that kind of Frank Sinatra shot down in Flying High in March, shot down in May, or whatever that line is.
Up there, there's Juliana in the middle blowing Heath a kiss, his hair and makeup.
Yeah, and Karina, who is the equestrian dresser, also the daughter of the production designer. And also one of the editorial assistants.
Is that right?
Yeah. There's Old St. Paul's, the steeple of Old St. Paul's there in the background. Again, Ridley Scott, thank you very much.
Now, at some point, don't you see the Millennium Wheel, but made out of wood?
Yeah,
London Millennium Wheel, but made out of wood.
Absolutely. And here you are, you demanded that the song keep playing, so that's why we didn't fade out till you actually entered frame.
Unbelievable.
Commanded it. He was forced to disband his army. They were reveling the night, pillaging town after...
In reveling the night, that doesn't go on much anymore, except maybe in Rufus's apartment in Prague.
There was a lot of reveling.
And I think when Rufus rides up and says committing the oldest sins in the newest ways, he knows what he's talking about.
Chance to face each other again, Sir Ulrich.
And at the World Championship.
As I promised you before, Adamar, you will look up...
See, yet another tempting opportunity for a double entendre and not taken, Brian.
Yeah.
I'm ashamed of you.
Although it shows restraint, and I think that's an important thing also for a writer.
Well, in my absence, on the field.
Now here's some innuendo. I feel it's innuendo coming up.
Horses, women.
Do you put them in that order?
Generally.
This is where we work some zen into the movie with the Jocelyn not being a target but an arrow, and I think zen is very important.
In life generally, or this film specifically?
Real thoroughbred.
I think in life generally.
Okay.
You speak of Jocelyn like she's a dog.
And of course,
isn't she?
Well, I don't want to say any more about it, except just never underestimate the power of Zen. And that's also, we might have to re-record that little bit there too, I think.
Yeah, that's...
I had gone out on a comedy limb, and then realized that the limb I was sawing was actually the limb I was standing on. That shot right there. Heath came up with it. He said, if I turn around and look back at the camera, you can rack back to me. And it actually worked great.
Really
it's a nice moment. You know, Rufus is, these are kind of like two prize fighters at the weigh-in. And one is trying to get under the other's skin. And I think Rufus has very successfully planted doubt into Heath's mind there.
He's getting under Heath's skin just like herpes might.
There's Mark again. Guan, which is kind of a football, soccer/football chant.
Guan.
Guan. Go on, my son. I always like, this is kind of Ulrich von Lichtenstein as a well-oiled machine. Now, there's a very interesting moment coming up where we do a hard zoom into Heath, which in fact was a mistake. The camera operator is just trying to get in on the frame size that he's supposed to be at, right here.
Yeah.
And here you see it. That's just a camera operator trying not to get fired. That's the size he should be at. And he was not there. And we saw it. And it's kind of a tribute to the 70s and the zoom.
Did you fire him?
Yeah.
Yeah, good.
I know, this is not real rain. This is movie rain.
How do you do that?
It's one of those secrets that on the day you graduate from film school, they reveal the secret of movie rain to you. And you're sworn to secrecy never to let anyone but... another film school graduate know.
Okay, but how do you do that?
We have towers, and we pump water up to the top of them, and giant sprinkler heads that spin around and send the rain down.
You've just, have you just broken some movie school rule?
I have.
Cool.
I have, and I'll have to live kind of like Salman Rushdie the rest of my life.
No, there'll be a fatwa.
Yeah.
Now, this is the sweetest kid in the whole world.
Yeah. The funny thing is, when I was casting for this part, there's a line that the young actor has to say, which is, he's blind, sir, revealing that William's father is blind. And when all the little boys came in, and the actor is supposed to say, he sits by the window, but no one knows why. And William says, what do you mean? And the child is supposed to say, he's blind, sir. And all the little boys came in and just went, he's blind. And when the little girl started coming in, every one of them took this big kind of sniffly breath and went, he's blind, sir. So I think that's really the difference between little girls, little boys, and later on men and women. That's why that Sugar and Spice and Puppy Dog Tales, I think, is a lot to be said for the truth of that. He's blind, sir, being a puppy dog tale kind of reaction. with the line you're about to hear being a Sugar and Spice kind of thing.
There you go.
So right now we're coming up to a great set that Tony Barrow, the production designer, built of a staircase, and it was all opened up. It cost about $50,000.
Really?
Yeah, and we were supposed to follow him from the inside on a single, like, boom up. And then when we watched it, it took about 18 minutes for him to get up the stairs. And when we needed to lose 18 minutes, that's where it went. So all we actually have left is the last three steps. And that's the kind of thing a production designer needs to take his heart out and stamp on it right there. I just want to point out, mending a fishing net, a thing I've seen my uncles do, and I've seen my dad do. That's why it's in there. Thank you very much.
Someone there?
Again, we're on a set now, so that rain that you're seeing now is really fake rain. The previous rain was just fake rain, and now it's really fake rain.
This is really, 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 really fake rain.
Yeah.
A night.
It's a funny thing about this line where he says, I've heard that name chanted from the stadium. When we were trying to adjust the rain, Guy Travers, who was the first assistant director, looked out the window. We're on a soundstage, but he looked out the window and he said, I bet the father could hear them chanting his name in the stadium. And as soon as he said it, I said, Guy, you're a genius, you know, and went right to Chris and said, when he says Ulrich, say, I hear them chanting that name from the stadium, which is kind of a nice thought.
This is Brian Helgeland really pulling the heartstrings here.
Which is why we have the harp even playing in the background a little bit. I think it's a harp. I'm going to get an angry phone call from the composer if it isn't. Or it's a lute, maybe, plucking on a lute. I forget. Now I'm trying to back off of my statement now, but I'm afraid I don't have the stamina to stay with that one. Again, Chris wearing cataract contact lenses.
I'm still managing to cry.
Yeah. doing a really lovely job, I think.
Father.
I'm not going to make fun of this scene, if you won't.
I'm certainly not going to make fun of it.
There's the window. There's a candle burning up there in the window. We have no... What I always wonder is why a blind man has so many candles in his apartment.
And so that there's enough light for the camera to be able to pick up
that's probably
people's
it.
Features and stuff.
That's probably it. I don't think that's any of his business, really, if he asks if there's a certain girl or many, but so be
he
it.
He hasn't seen it for years. Yeah. He dumped him off with a guy called Hector.
What business is it of his, who William's dating?
Well, but this leak won't do, Father.
And the question is, does he really want to fix the leak, or is he using it to get out of an embarrassing conversation with his dad?
About his girlfriend.
Yeah. It's none of the old geezer's business, I don't think.
No, none of his business.
No. Maybe if you keep your kid and you don't give him away when he's a little boy, you can
it
ask questions like that.
It might be some of your business.
Yeah. Again, the most kind of dark cues seem to follow Rufus wherever he goes in this film, and this is another one of them. I want to point out that there's a guitar in there that's being played by a guy named David Torn, who, if you're a composer watching the film, run out and get David Torn. Again, thank
were
you.
Were there guitars in the?
There were.
Now this is
the
amazing.
Millennium Wheel is visible at the top of frame in the right, and this again is thanks to Ridley Scott.
This is not actually computer generated. It's a model.
It's a model with the actual set in the middle where he's riding, and cost $500,000.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Wow. I
remember. Jeff. Joseph.
It's hard for a guy wearing a jacket like that to look that grim.
Yeah.
But you pull it off somehow.
Here comes some enormous overacting. There you go. Slight break in the voice. Terrible.
to try to take the edge off it, I cut away from you.
Thank you.
Followed you last night. The cheap side.
How anyone knows any of the things they're talking about right now is beyond me, because we've cut all the scenes out that show them learning all these things, but somehow we didn't need them after all.
They're waiting for you in the lists. They're going to arrest you. A dozen royal guards.
Now, if you count them later on, there are a dozen.
Are there?
You say a dozen royal guards, and there are a dozen royal guards.
Well, that's the kind of detail that a writer would kind of, you know, pick up on.
Yeah, that's research. That's a case of exemplary research. Again, it's another key moment here. He wants to know what she thinks.
Hold.
And as he says hold, we cut out wide to, in fact, show everybody holding. And I don't mean the Todd Black kind of holding.
To know what you are, William, would take a lifetime. One I am most willing to give, but right now you've got to run.
Again,
there's nothing else.
This is the test for him. Is he going to run, or isn't he going to run?
I would have run.
Yeah, I would have too. And of course, everyone becomes spineless all of a sudden. Everyone telling him to run. And I don't know how that really works, how everyone loses their confidence here at the last minute.
I love you.
Well... there's not many literary figures that do that. There's that also remain heroes. There's Falstaff,
right.
Scooby-Doo, and us in this movie, and that's pretty much it.
And I think that's Alan Tudyk has a kind of Shaggy thing going on during the film. And works very well.
Why he wasn't cast in that movie is a crying shame.
Yeah, he was born to be Scooby-Doo.
Absolutely.
He wouldn't agree with us, but he's
It's the minor 49er, Scoobs!
The Pigs Inside in Winter was a classic line that all the girls who came in and read for the part had to say, where will we live with the pigs, with the pigs? And Francine Maisler, who brilliantly cast the film... when I used to call them from Prague once in a while to see how they were doing, they would all run around in the background yelling, the pigs, with the pigs, with the pigs, which always kind of gave me the strength to carry on, kind of dark moments. So thank you, Francine, and your entire staff. Now he's looking for a little help. You know, you turn around, you look at your buddies, and you want just a little, can you guys help me out a little bit here?
No. No is the answer.
It's kind of an every man for himself moment, isn't it?
Yep.
Let's divide the money and get out
every
of Dodge.
Every ham for himself, yeah. Actually.
Now, you'd think Watt, with all his talk of kicking people, i.e. fonging, you think he'd stand in there right now.
Yeah, but the thing about Watt is he's all gung and no dinner.
Yeah, he's all what's the expression, all pants? No, all talk and no pants?
He's all talk and no...
Trousers.
Yeah.
Even Kate. Everyone telling him to run.
No! But he won't.
He won't. He will not.
Oh, look at that. I love the way that tension string comes in with her tears coming down
her
face.
Yeah, it's weird how things like that coincidentally happen once in a while.
Amazing.
And you have no idea how. But it's just beautiful. You know you're on the right track when that happens. And weirdly, when the strings are playing over the tears, it's just like, oh my God, how'd that happen?
Shocking.
Yeah.
Synchronicity.
Again, this is an orchestra playing, which has really very little bearing
on. He's brilliant.
Yeah, Mark is.
He also has the ability to grow a lighter moustache and a darker beard.
Yeah,
which is important in movie
making. It's a character builder. I think not since Sean Connery have we seen that kind of skill.
Never.
Although in his case, it was a lighter beard and a darker moustache.
Yeah.
This I stole this shot from The Right Stuff.
Good.
And of course, it's better in the right stuff than it is here, but nonetheless, I
still stole it.
The Mercury astronauts right there. And there you can see the 12 with a dozen Royal Guard coming in to arrest William.
A dozen Royal Guard, yeah. Ladies and gentlemen.
Now, you'll see Barney had no idea these guys were going to rush Heath, and you'll see Barney lose it for real. He's not acting.
Mark Addy brilliantly kind of keeping that horse.
Brilliantly keeping Barney and himself alive. Now, Jermaine, I think right here, thinks maybe we're not on the right path. Maybe the path of evil is not the correct path.
I think you're right.
Here's a scene. It's Mark Addy dubbed it Hell in the Cell. And I had cut it out of the film, thinking I didn't need it. And the entire cast separately did another intervention and convinced me to put it back in.
No, it's a great scene.
He that strives to touch a star oft stumbles at a simple straw.
So there, you don't change your stars if you stumble on a straw. And the key thing being that Thatcher used straw to make roofs.
Clever.
So anyone who, there's a scene where you learn that. So any kids out there, a Thatcher is a roof maker. And that's why he's got the piece of straw. He's kind of rubbing that fact in his face.
You have been measured.
Again with the you have been measured, weighed, measured, and found wanting.
Now this has a line in it, this scene, which is, it's one loss or another, which is my favorite line in the movie.
One loss or another.
There you go.
And it's also, speaking of identity, it's where Rufus, his character, Adhemar, really realizes that he's not quite the jouster and the guy he thought he was, I think. I mean, that's to me how Rufus always played it, when you can see that doubt right there in his eyes. And I think he regrets hitting Heath at the end of the day. Didn't make him feel good.
Do you not think?
That I'm reading too much into it.
Yeah, I think you enjoyed hitting. He's the baddie.
I'm suddenly trying to turn it into a more serious film here, having looking more towards posterity. I think at the final moments, and I'm going to just get a hold of myself and stop doing it. And of course, the band that is urging him to run is now
standing by him.
God love you, William. I think right here you got John Entwistle. Roger Daltrey in the stocks. Here comes Keith Moon coming in. And Paul Bettany is Pete Townsend, which I guess would make Kate Peter Grant the manager of Led Zeppelin. Although I don't know why he's with the Who right now. She's with the Who.
Okay, there was a speech here that was cut out that you'll probably find in your extras menu.
Yeah, in deleted scenes, Paul Bettany laying it all on the line. But unfortunately, when we watched it, it just felt like by the time you were done, you had so thoroughly saved him and endeared him to all of London that there was really nothing left for the Black Prince to do.
Twice, Mr. Bond. What a pair we are. Look at him.
Again, voted the sexiest member of the cast by the female members of the crew.
Yeah, I'm slightly hurt by that.
You can see the mark of the cabbage right there on the stocks. Now, I always thought he's kind of totally left Laura out of this moment. He says, your men love you. What does he think she is?
You're absolutely right.
And yet, the original line was, your men and your woman love you, but it was pointed out to me that wasn't medieval, so I dropped it.
Oh, good.
It's weird how the music starts playing. Like, of all the times it should start playing.
So, the luck.
Yeah.
Now just...
James basically got this part because of the way he says, take a knee.
Take
a knee.
May appear to be of humble origins. But my personal historians have.
Again, you can't buy that jacket in stores. He's got his pimp jacket on now. Gold leaf, the Prince of Wales emblem, the three lions.
It's out of fashion now.
Yeah.
And as such is beyond
contestation.
Always since I was a young man, I had wanted to write a script with the word contestation in it.
You
and I had
did
to,
it.
I had to wait till now. Here's the line coming up. If I may repay the kindness you once showed me. Take a knee.
Take a knee. There you go.
Now that looks easy.
See, that's why he earns the big bucks.
Yeah. And by the way, he's not scarred like that. That's a movie scar on his right
that's
cheek.
That's a movie scar for anybody thinking of casting him as James Bond.
Yeah, if you're saying we could never cast a guy with a scar like that on his face as James Bond, well, then he can take it right off. King Edward.
And by all the witnesses here.
Here's a nice wide shot that tells the story right there.
Sir William.
That was nice. You closed your eyes very nicely.
Thank you. I learned that at drama school. That's the sort of thing they teach it.
Arise, Sir William.
And he's Sir William now. He was always Sir William in his heart.
But
now, finally.
On paper.
On paper as well. Not that he cares, but it's important to everyone else. Is my tournament to finish? One of my favorite lines in the movie for no reason when he says, you look for his shield on the lists. I don't know what.
Yeah,
I don't know. I don't even know what it means.
Nor have I. I've got no idea what that means.
You look for his shield on the lists. There we go.
What were you thinking of?
Yeah.
Still sounds nice.
It does. It does. And a little secret, those weren't actually those guys playing.
Oh, really?
Yeah. This girl was... The Black Prince was actually married to the Duchess of Kent, who was supposed to be the most beautiful woman in Europe.
Here's Scott Handy trying to do an impression of Chaucer doing the introductions and being brilliant.
And this right here is the very dangerous moment where we reveal that Rufus is going to attack Heath with a number 2 pencil.
2B.
That smacks a little bit of a movie line. It's a small target, Will, but aim for his heart.
Yeah, well, I like it. I wanted to say but aim for his penis, but I thought it was ill-advised.
Yeah.
Him up!
Scott's great here as he realizes that he's pulled it off. You're ready to pass out, practically. Now, I know I did this whole sequence once earlier with all the close-ups, but it worked so well the first time, I thought I'd do it again. And it's got that kind of quick cutting that the kids, the MTV kids, really love.
They love that kind
of
thing.
And just for anyone who wants to know when to cut, it's a good, when the helmet starts to come down, it's a natural place to cut to the close-up of the helmet coming down.
Absolutely. Action cut.
Now... Here you are. You didn't know it when we shot it, but you're going to stop the guy from dropping the flag.
Right.
Oh, no, not now. I'm sorry. It's later on. Yeah.
Rufus has to do his dastardly deed.
Yeah.
Yes.
We have a lot of weather problems here where sometimes you'll notice we're in the sunshine and then the next shot we're in the shade. And we had weather nightmares the whole last couple of weeks of shooting, so we had to just make do. We didn't have those big budgets that some of those directors have, and we had to just live with what we had. Live with what God gives you, they say. You see a nice shot of Rufus's fist, Coronel, there. And that's a shot that I'm not very proud of. It's one of the assistants dropped the film magazine and flashed the film at the end of the day and didn't tell anyone. And it was the last day of shooting, and we didn't know it till we got home. So here in the final sequence, there's a couple of shots where everything looks a little milky, and that's why.
Is that right?
Yeah.
When was that?
On the last day of, because second unit had one day after first unit, and one of the assistants dropped a mag of film, and it split, and it flashed the film that was inside. And that...
Did you have him killed?
We didn't. We're looking for him, though.
Right.
But that's the responsibility of a camera assistant to say that happened.
Actually, that is an enormous amount of pressure doing that job. I wouldn't want to do it.
Yeah, he's got to load the film. Well, that's the film loader, actually. But there you see the tip has been broken off inside of him. It's a number 2 pencil.
If you get lead inside your body, it can be quite tricky and dangerous.
And it finds a vein, and it works its way down until it gets you in the heart.
Yeah, gets you right in the heart.
So he really has to try to win this thing before that point works its way down into his heart.
That's the sort of
ticking clock.
Ticking clock. Boom.
Beautiful eyes that Rufus Sewell has.
See, now he can hardly hold that lance because he's been stabbed by a huge 2B pencil.
Yeah. In the grand scheme of, in the grand test of life, he's been checked off.
Yeah.
And they fill the box in completely.
Boom. And you can see the spaghetti there. You can see the linguine.
We always shoot these scenes right before lunch, and then we scoop it all up and boil it up for lunch. There you can see the children of the devil basically rooting for evil Pan Adamar.
They are the children of the devil.
All good children, of course. They know who to cheer for. There was another one of those milky shots right there.
Mm.
I don't think he's saying to Kate that he can't breathe as an accusation to her, really. He's just trying to...
Good, yeah, because he was so pleased with the armor a little while ago, and then he says, I can never breathe with it on.
Yeah, yeah.
I guess in the heat of the moment, that's the sort of thing that you would say, though.
You lash out sometimes.
You can.
And here you are again with a message. A message.
A message.
A message.
It's like a message, but slightly different.
And it's often used in chivalry.
Yeah.
As a kind of defense against the Shiv.
Shiv.
Use your message.
Yeah. Parry with your message.
Yeah. Yeah. You must unhorse him or kill him. The only way to win. That's the Burgess Meredith, coach coming out.
Yeah.
You gotta kill this Kid Rock.
Hit him, Rocky.
You need more padding.
No, leave it off.
Now, when we were shooting, I felt that a little patch of red was enough. It was kind of William's red badge of courage. And then the first time we tested the movie, everyone said, where in the world is his injury? So we actually had the CGI in the...
Is it bigger?
In the lance hole.
Oh, really?
Lash it to my arm.
I have nothing really left to say at this point.
At this point?
Yeah.
For the whole movie?
Well, I'm going to come up with something, but I run dry a little bit.
Oh, good. Let it run dry. Let it. There'll be a little gap now. Go out and get some tea or, you know, some popcorn.
And we've been at this for 2 hours, and I think it's very difficult to really come up with anything left to say at this point.
No, I haven't been funny for about the last half an hour. Oh, look.
There you go.
Here I go. This is very dangerous, ladies and gentlemen.
This is another one of the days where I arrived on set and you had rewritten all your dialogue.
Yeah, sorry about that.
And you said, I will lay rest the grace in my tongue.
Yeah.
And I was always unsure about that because I felt that that was pointing up the grace in your tongue, saying I would lay rest the grace in my tongue.
Well, that's the kind of rosy-cheeked tomfoolery that I think Chaucer would have come up with.
It is, really. And that's the Royal Box up in the London Stadium, which in Rouen, when you looked across, there was nothing there, because Rouen Stadium and London Stadium being the same location.
Harriet! One of your own! Born a stone's throw from this very stadium!
He's born a stone's throw away, which is why the father could hear the Ulrich chant.
Exactly.
Just to tie everything together in a neat little package here at the end.
Now, I know this is enormously sentimental, but I love this little next bit with Alan.
Yeah.
That's your name, Will.
And the amazing thing about Alan is he found a way to be so funny, but make a believable character out of it, so that when he goes to this moment, you're with him and you believe it. So it's the final showdown.
Here we go.
This is what we all came for.
This is the cowboy moment.
Yeah. So we're the final face-off. Rufus is being brought into position. We got another one of those kind of milky shots. I gotta point it out. I don't know if anyone kind of really doubts what's going to happen, but I guess you want to see how it's going to happen.
You just want to see it happen.
Yeah, you just want to see it happen. And someone said, why didn't you kill Rufus at the end? But it's really, he doesn't deserve death, I don't think. And
yes, he does.
Well, that's true. But we can always, we can bring him back for the sequel.
Just
though.
For those parties.
Yeah. I mean his character, Count Adamar.
Spitting.
Kids shouldn't do that.
Don't do that at home.
Yeah.
Unless you have a spittoon.
Yeah. Which is kind of 18th century.
Yeah. Your father might have one if he chews tobacco.
This is Barney, the Wonder Horse, going on his final ride. Very fine shot right there, in my opinion.
Now, would you say that this moment is about identity, too?
This is about identity, which is why he screams his name at the end.
Oh, right.
Yeah. So anyone who thought this was just a bit of fluff, they now know it's a film about identity. And I really think that's important. This is one of my favorite. That coronel that just went by hit the Steadicam operator in the head.
Did it?
Yeah. And it was the second to last shot in the film. And he put on a helmet after that. And
really?
We all said, you know, there's only one shot left. It's not going to happen twice. And it didn't.
You have been
of course, these are his own words coming back to haunt him. And this, the idea here was always that this was a fantasy of Adamar's as he was falling. He kind of sees time stands still. You can see he's a little bit above the ground. He's suspended in space. And he actually, he sees himself. After everyone goes away, he even sees himself go over.
Where's that bit?
That's coming up. You cut back down to him, and now he's about to see himself fly overhead.
Oh.
Not many people get that because it's so confusing.
And so subtle. Oh, there you go.
Now, here's a nice shot. A lot of nice dirt going up in the air. We got the coronel skidding along. Everyone's celebrating.
Everybody's happy.
Everyone wins.
Mainly because the shoot's over and we can all go home.
Yeah. I can wrap up 6 months in the Czech Republic.
Yeah.
Fans are throwing medieval toilet paper out of the stands. Got a nice shot of the cataract.
Yeah.
Contact lenses. He actually said he would be on his back, but he's on his face, so I don't really know what to say at all. Here's Germaine, turns out to be not so bad after all. And then just a lot of celebration going on.
And as in all movies like this, the hero's arm miraculously gets better quite quickly.
Yeah. Especially when there's some kissing princesses.
You know there's some kissing princesses left to do.
Yeah.
Well, I'm frankly glad that you're stuck with us through this, and you will now know how to proceed in life, having seen this movie.
Yep.
It's about honor, it's about friendship, and it's about...
identity.
Thank you.
Figuring out who you are and being true to whoever that is.
Actually, I do like this bit, because the conceit of the movie is that this takes place during Chaucer's six-month period. We don't know what Chaucer was doing, after which he wrote about common people.
Yep. All human activity lies within the artist's scope.
And it's also a reprise of that maybe not you gag that you wrote.
Yeah. And we worked it all in. We never forgot anything we did. We're coming up to the stars and Alan Graf, who I could not have made this film without. There's his name.
Brilliant.
And
Funniest man you're likely to meet as well.
I've taken some flack. Not really some flack, but people keep saying, how can you have the modern and the old? And I remember that old Reese's Peanut Butter Cup commercial where you got chocolate on my peanut butter. No, you got peanut butter on my chocolate. And to me, what this movie is all about is you got Chaucer on my queen. No, wait, you got queen on my Chaucer.
Nice one.
And I think there's a world somewhere in the continuum of time and space, worlds collide. And this just happens to be where this world collided
exactly.
With the other world.
Sam Stokes.
Now, God bless all my crew, but I cannot pronounce a lot of their last names because it's a language that's desperately trying to keep the last five letters of the alphabet alive. So, but nothing, you know, they're great, a great group of people.
Di Hopkins, there he is, ladies and gentlemen, a genius.
Yep, David Gray.
A god amongst men.
There you have it, cat meat hot wine and the ferryman.
Fantastic.
You know, people
Pavel,
talk
which is Czech for Paul.
Yeah.
I'll point that out.
People talk about a film by credit, which I don't believe in, for the very reason that we're looking at 800 different names here, all of whom worked on the film. And far be it from me to take credit away from all of them.
Exactly.
Although anyone who might be voting for me for a Directors Guild Award, I didn't really say that. And please reconsider. And anyone who watched this entire commentary, they're the champions, I think.
Yeah. Thanks for putting up with us.
Our hat's off to you.
Yeah, you've been lovely, and we've been Paul and Brian. Thank you very much.
You kind of set a line that we could have wrapped up on, but I'm going to just keep talking.
Good.
Not knowing when I've overstayed my welcome. And also very kind of anxious. Here again, Ridley Scott and all his people, the Mill Film Company. We have Ridley to thank. And in a weird way, we have Ridley to thank for Tony Scott, because they're brothers. And Ridley, I think, is the older brother. And he could have, as older brothers sometimes do to younger brothers, he could have kind of...
Squished him down,
not allowed him to express himself.
Same thing happened with Jake Scott.
Yeah.
You know, the son.
So we thank them.
Thank you. Thank you for Tony and Jake.
Yeah. Here's some song credits. And Ridley, we just ran out of... We're running out of things to talk about, so we don't mean any offense. We are desperately clutching at straws here.
Yeah.
Sly and the Family Stone. You don't see them all the time anymore. They're not around, I don't think.
Talking about us rambling, I think it was Oscar Wilde said, one never says so much as when one doesn't know what to say.
And now having really
no... we're living proof of that.
Having no idea what else to say, we're going to, I guess, call it a day and allow Mark Addy, Alan Tudyk, Laura Frazier, and the one and only Paul Bettany finish this film in a way that only they could have.
Yeah.
And
we came up with this off the cuff. It's probably quite witty. You've probably never seen anything like this before.
Shooting in the basement of an actual castle in the middle of the Czech countryside.
In the middle of the Czech
this
countryside.
This is the inspiration we drew from the moment.
Yeah, clever this. This is one of the cleverest gags that you're likely to see.
No one will ever say I'm not an artist. Alan Tudyk kind of never given up. Thank you, Paul.
Thank you, Brian.
You're